And that is the third topic of this presentation, dissolving the periodic table in silicon and germanium. For this audience, I don't have to explain that doping silicon and germanium is very important. And one of the first questions you want to answer when you dope it is, where does my impurity element sit? These two pictures here are experimental overviews of the information we have about impurity positions in silicon and germanium from experiments. I will not discuss these two pictures in detail, just highlight two features. There are many white spots. There are many elements for which we do not know the position. And there are some differences between silicon and germanium, like here the 3D elements in silicon. They take an interstitial position, while in germanium, they take a substitutional position. Can this be understood? Well, that was a question that was tackled 2 years ago by the previous speaker and by the chairman of the program committee of this conference. They studied the host lattice silicon, host lattice germanium for 4 different positions of all impurities at this same level of density functional theory as we are using, and they observe indeed in agreement with experiments that there are interstitial sites for the 3D elements in silicon and substitutional ones for the 3D elements in germanium. So, problem solved. However, there is one unfortunate aspect about such an approach, and that is that this level of DFT, the GGA level of DFT, predicts germanium to be a metal. Bad news. How can we trust a geometry analysis if such a basic feature as germanium being a semiconductor is incorrectly predicted by the method? So that's where we try to improve on. So this was the kind of computational settings that were was used in this previous study. First, we do similar calculations using the same exchange correlation functional, but exactly that PBE form for which we did all this error bar analysis. We do it with a different code, but that shouldn't matter. We take a bit more elements, a bit more sites, and then we set the step to a hybrid functional, which is computationally much more demanding, but which is a level of theory at which germanium is correctly be predicted to be a semiconductor. What is the result of this? Well, first, the germanium at PBE level, so this should reproduce the previous calculations, and indeed, we have all the substitutional 3D impurities here. Now you set a step to the hybrid functional, and what do we see? Interstitial 3D impurities in disagreement with experiment. So we're back to square one. The problem that we thought was solved is not solved at all. Now, I cannot tell you what is the reason for this disagreement. There can be several paths to examine. It can be a temperature effect. It can be a precision problem in these hybrid functional calculations, where precision is not yet that well under control as at the PBE level. Time will tell what is happening there. Now, more important than this disagreement is what you can do now with this set of information. Because we have, for 2 host lattices, 6 different impurity positions for 73 different elements. That's a lot of information. We make this information available in a database that comes with the paper which will be published. And this is something you can start using for your own work. So I will illustrate by an example where you do not do any additional DFT calculation, but where you can gain new information out of that database. I hope this will inspire you to apply such reasonings to problems that are of interest to you. The problem I take here is, how can we suppress void formation during the grout of a germanium single crystal? One possibility would be to add an impurity element that traps the seeds before they orbit. The first concept of situation where we have a solution in beauty far away from and the end of the is set by the horizontal line. Beware that the system of the fancy is trapped by the impurity. The energy is there, often it will be lower. And the energy difference between both, that is this trapping enthalpy. I will now plot, first in a cartoon and later with real data, I will plot this trapping enthalpy as a function of the impurity element. And my cartoon looks like this. We will reason first about the cartoon, and then it is straightforward to understand the real data. Not all of these trapping enthalpies are suitable. If we examine the energy that is released when two vacancies combine, well, the energy that is released when the vacancy combines with the trap should be lower. If not, the vacancy prefers to cluster rather than to be trapped. So we can exclude that range, and that would be a range where vacancy clustering happens. Another boundary is set by the energy it needs to create a vacancy. So all these trapping enthalpies are negative, so if they are at the bottom of the scale, if they are maximally negative, a lot of energy is released when the vacancy gets trapped. And if that is more energy than you need to create a vacancy, then every trapping event will create new vacancies. So the trapping is not effective at all. So we should exclude also that region. The region that is white is the region where good trapping happens, but not every place there is equally suitable. If you are to the top of the white region, then the vacancies are only weakly bound, so preferably they should be stronger bound. And if you are at the bottom of the white region, there are only few free traps available waiting for vacancies to capture. So somewhere in the middle, there should be an optimal trade-off between these two tendencies. And the elements, the impurities for which this optimal trade-off is reached, these are the good candidates that you would like to study experimentally. Now, this was for the cartoon. If you put this on the real data, where we have this trapping enthalpies taken from our database in the shape of the periodic table, then you see in black the regions that have been excluded. And the red squares are the elements that are on this optimal compromise line. So these would be the good trapping elements that you could consider experimentally for substitutional impurities in germanium. We have done such an analysis also for interstitial impurities. We can combine both to find impurities that can act as a double trap, so that can capture a vacancy as an interstitial, and then when they have become a substitutional one by that trapping, they can trap a next one as a substitutional defect. We have made an attempt to add some temperature information to this, and so this is an example how you can reason, how you can get physical conclusions that are industrially relevant from such a database. I hope that by offering this database to all of you, that by your own imagination, you can find new applications for this.